Hello, I'm Glenn Fay, Education Director at CIS. For years, maths education has been in steep decline in Australia, highlighted by our poor PISA results, as well as our own CIS research. With this in mind, we invited one of our nation's leading educators, Greg Ashman, to give us his take on how to raise the bar. Greg is Head of Mathematics and Head of Research at Ballarat Clarendon College, as well as being a prolific blogger and podcaster. Please enjoy his presentation.
I want to show you this graph. So what I've done here is nothing very special. The top line, and this is the AMSI, Australian Mathematical Sciences Institute, they do a survey every year where they talk about, they measure essentially who's taking higher and intermediate level maths courses at the year 12 level. In my state of Victoria, the intermediate level is known as math methods, and the higher level is known as specialist maths, and in New South Wales there are similar courses. And so they look at the proportion throughout Australia, and you can see that the proportion taking intermediate, that top line there, that's declining, it's been declining. There's a bit of a dip, which is actually related to Queensland going to a test-based system from a coursework system, interestingly. The bottom line is the higher maths course. So that's, in my state, that's specialist maths. So this is the really technical stuff with differential equations and things like that. Both courses have calculus in. The specialist maths has a slightly more advanced level of calculus. And then in the middle, I've plotted Australia's PISA results over the same period, and that's the scale at the right-hand side. Now, not all correlations are causation. I'm going to make a case that for something that's not actually popular, even though it's obvious. Even though it's obvious, it's not a popular idea. So this is what everybody thinks, right? That if you want to get students to do maths, you need to motivate them. Yes, you need to get them going. So particularly girls, because we're always concerned about girls and maths achievements. So what you need to do, you need to herd these 14-year-old, 15-year-old girls into a room. You need to put a very inspirational maths teacher in front of them who's going to motivate them. And then they're going to go away, and then they're going to learn lots of maths because they're so motivated, and that's going to lead to their achievement in maths. This is what everybody thinks. However, this is probably not the case. The motivation you're going to get from that speaker or from that really cool activity or from whatever it is that you think is motivational is going to last a short period of time. If you want students to be motivated about maths, you want them to be motivated over an extended period of time. And the way that you do that is you give them a sense of achievement. Because when you're getting better at something, you feel good about yourself and you feel good about the something. Not a difficult idea to get your head around. And in fact, a couple of years ago, I'm showing my age, probably about 2016, I think it was, there was a study done in Canada. And they tracked elementary school students in maths, and they measured their motivation for maths at time one and their achievement at time one. And then later on, they measured their motivation for maths at time two and their achievement at time two. They found that motivation did not predict later achievement. They found that achievement did predict later motivation. Now, that's at one extreme. If you look at the consensus on this field, this sort of motivational field, and it's really complex because these motivational constructs, we call them, they're all slightly different and they all measure slightly different things, self-efficacy, self-concept, personal interest. It's quite a swamp when you get into it all and try and figure it all out. But the overall consensus is that there's probably a two-way relationship. So motivation does, unlike in the Canadian study, it probably does affect later achievement, but achievement affects later motivation. So why, in that context, would we, when we see our declining performance on a robust external measure — I'm not a huge fan of PISA, but it's fairly robust, it's an external measure, we don't get to control it, we don't get to fix the system so that we're always getting better scores on it. It's out there, it's not under our control. So it's fairly robust. If that's declining, so kids at the age of 15, that's what PISA measures, don't know as much more maths as they used to, then is it really surprising that fewer of them are choosing to do maths at higher and intermediate level when they're in year 11 and 12. But this is not the conversation people are having, ladies and gentlemen. They're not talking about that. They're not connecting achievement with students taking these courses. They're thinking it's about a whole load of other things because they're stuck on the idea that motivation has to precede achievement. And it leads to some funny effects. 18 times 5. There's a professor of maths education in the US called Jo Bowler. She actually hails from my part of the world. She supports West Bromwich Albion, which is very unfortunate. But she wrote, I was reading a book that she wrote, Mathematical Mindsets, and she talks at great length about 18 by 5 and all the different ways you can solve 18 by 5. And she went to Silicon Valley because there's lots of easily enthused people in Silicon Valley, it appears. So she went to Silicon Valley and she said, show me how you can solve 18 by 5. And they came up with all these different ways of multiplying 18 by 5. And they got so excited and enthused about it that they made T-shirts with 18 times 5 on the T-shirts. And the question arises, why? But this isn't quite an important point. There's a lot of activity that happens in maths with no purpose. A few years ago at my place, we had this one teacher, they had this thing called, what was it called? Greedy Pig, I think it was called, and it involved a big dice. And you rolled the dice down the middle of the classroom. And because this one teacher did it, the other teachers wanted to do it too, because they didn't want their kids to miss out on doing the Greedy Pig with the dice. And I said, but what's it for? What maths are we trying to teach through this activity? And no one could clearly articulate what they were trying to do. And in a lot of maths, this is what happens. People have this vague sense that if we're doing something with numbers, we're doing maths. And that's just enough, because kids will just learn maths. And so without having a clearly worked out idea of what we're trying to do. And I think that this is connected to this idea that we have around motivation as well. Another big issue we have in maths is everyone sees it functionally. Everyone says, well, when am I ever going to have to solve quadratic equations at the supermarket? Why are you making me learn this stuff? What's the point? Well, you won't. But you probably don't even need to add up at the supermarket because you're just going to tap your card. You don't need to know much stuff. You can be profoundly ignorant in 21st century society and survive. Is that what you want? Why is it that maths is measured by this functional standard that we need to be able to do mundane things with it? We don't do that with other subjects. We don't hold them to that. So, well, sometimes people do that. So why have we got to learn Shakespeare? That's the same kind of stupidity. Okay, so this activity-based thing caused me to come up with a few years ago, slightly tongue-in-cheek, and I decided to name it after myself, Ashman's First Principle of Educational Psychology. Students tend to learn the things you teach them and don't tend to learn the things that you don't teach them. But this is the point. If we're just creating these activities and pushing kids through activities and not really thinking about what we're trying to achieve, what we want them to learn as a result of it, that's a big problem. Now, here we go. That all precedes what we often think about as the debate. So the Australian draft mathematics curriculum was published, I think it was April last year, something like that, and it really pushed a particular teaching style. Now, a curriculum document is not supposed to do that. A curriculum document is supposed to lay out what it is we want students to know, okay? What we're trying to teach them. Instead, it had lots of sort of kids should do this activity or do that activity. They should investigate. They should problem solve. So it really pushed a particular type of teaching that you might call inquiry learning, you might call problem-based learning, you might call constructivist teaching. There's all sorts of names for it because basically it doesn't work very well. So as soon as people figure that out, you change the name to something else. And then you have a go at that for a while. That doesn't work very well. So you change the name to something else. So it's got lots of names, this teaching style. But in a sense, that like what I've said about motivation and actually thinking about what you want the students to achieve, that's more foundational than these discussions about teaching style, which sort of sit on top of that. This is a very good book. It's quite expensive, but it's constructivist. It basically, as far as I'm concerned, it finishes that debate. If you read this book, one of the editors who started with an open mind read all the arguments for and against, in this term, constructivist instruction. But as I said, it's got many names. And came up with the view that what you want to do is you want to not do that. You want to teach the things that you want the students to learn explicitly. You want to break it down into small pieces, put those pieces back together, synthesize them. And eventually, if you want people to be able to do complex problem solving, that's probably the most effective way to get there. So again, this hints to what we need to do. We've got, at the moment in Australia, I would sense a lot of activity, a lot of people doing maths, a lot of people trying to motivate people about doing maths. Probably not the level, as Zig Engelmann, the famous advocate of direct instruction in the US, would say, not enough at the level of picky, picky, picky detail. Figuring out, this is what we want to learn. These are the small steps that we have to take to get students to that point. I think I'm done. Have I got any other slides? Oh yeah. That's just from the original draft of the Australian curriculum, which I thought was quite psychedelic. I quite like it. I'm done. Okay.